Femke Hergave is a designer and researcher. That's also what is mentioned in the little booklet with the exhibition. And she is looking at all kinds of mechanisms that are inside and deeply sometimes hidden in the realms of global finances, geopolitics, network powers, and the lot. In 2013, she was awarded the Young Designer Award, and that was for her work, Taxodus. And when I got curious, I found on internet, and Bij de Wereld Draait Door, a little interview. It was 3 minutes, 3.5 minutes with Femke. So that's the amount of time you get at DWDD. But nevertheless, it was very nice. And Taxodus is also going to be explained by Femke a little bit more. Consider yourself a multinational, which will not be very hard, who avoids paying taxes as much as possible. But more I'm not going to say about this. Femke is not only working as an internet artist or web artist or working or designing games, it's far larger than that, but she will explain herself. And earlier already I mentioned the book by Shani Orgat. I thought, let's bring it, so I have something tangible in my hands. Media Representation and the Global Imagination. I also looked at the internet, and there was also a presentation by you, where you gave with the presentation of the book, and you were also interviewed. And it was very nice to see. Shani Orgat is is a senior lecturer at the Department of Media and Communication at the London School of Economics. Usually it's always abbreviated LSE, but it's also political science. And we had a brief, very brief exchange, and Shani said, well, of course I'm not an art historian, but we didn't invite her to speak about art, but reflect upon what images and text and the dissemination through internet actually does. So it's about media representation in a global world, the interplay between media representation and global imagination. And there is referred to mediated intimacies, for instance, and the social power of the imagination. And these are all concepts that Shani works on.
Hi, thanks for the invitation. Great to be here. I'm gonna speak about my work, but I also gonna speak a lot about the kind of research and motivation around it and behind it. Because I will speak a lot about global finance, I have sometimes, I speak about immaterial things, so once in a while you see an image coming by that maybe not corresponds immediately to what I'm saying, but it's kind of documentation of field research, so bear with me. So this is the title of my presentation. How can we as human beings relate to and navigate in the new value systems, geographies, and semiotics that financial processes carve out? As an artist, this is the point of departure in my research. But why finance, you might ask? First of all, I'm interested in how finance can turn everything and everyone into an entity from which value can be extracted. The logic of financialization is about reducing the world into properties that can be remixed, interpreted, valued in financial terms. When potentially everything can be turned into a derivative, this also means that everything can be owned by someone else. Secondly, I got captivated by how global finance is everywhere, yet I cannot see, hear, touch, or meet it anywhere. It penetrates our lives all the time, but it doesn't manifest itself in any time or place. It's non-local. Its dimension is not perceivable for the human eye. It's there and not there at the same time. Let's for a moment look at finance as a hyper-object, which is a concept to explain objects so massively distributed in time and space as to transcend localization. For example, climate change or styrofoam. Hyper-objects need a material base to function. And what makes up this material base of global finance? Where can we encounter it? How can we engage with it? And how does it affect us? In my work, I make a connection between latency and colonial natural rubber plantations, trading algorithms and melting ice or co-location and landing points. Through installations, photographs, videos, and games, I try to mod global finance back into material condition, back into our site, back into our human experience. I like to run through three conditions relevant in my work and which allow finance and capital to operate globally yet become increasingly invisible to us. The first condition is dematerialization. Where wealth once had a material condition and was contextualized by its territory, it is now disconnected from a specific place, labor, or material production. In global finance, money is purely made from the circulation of other money. It can materialize from itself, it's like alchemy. I'm interested in how the dematerialization of money in the late 1960s coincided with concepts on the dematerialization of the art object. Perhaps we can read these dematerialized capital flows through the language of art. They are no longer based on territorialized material assets, but on abstraction, signs, ideas, information, and linguistic exchange. This is a very sort of simple collection work, you could say. I collected the names that are given to trading algorithms on the left, and on the right side, kind of distinctive patterns that these trading algorithms produce on traders' screens when they basically use specific strategies to manipulate pricing in the market. And names, yeah, you cannot read them very well here, but it's interesting because they use names like Stealth, Sniper, Gorilla, Crossfire, so it's really names that relate to combat. Maybe I go here. Rogue Waves is a work about probably one of the most opaque, automated, and speed-up processes of the present moment, high-frequency trading. In this work, the ultra-fast global financial transactions of computational trading are given a material form and physical presence. In the tradition of the talistics, that you probably all know, ancient objects such as bones, wooden sticks to record value and transactions, Rogue Wave consists of a series of engraved metal sticks. They each carry the cutout of a trading pattern connected to a specific event in which algorithms illegally manipulated financial markets through quote stuffing, spoofing gold prices, and stock manipulation. So it's a kind of speculative artifact. In the solid, aluminum signals are captured that move between computers around the world in milliseconds. Here's some details. The second thing that allows global finance to be nearly invisible is its underlying material base. There is an immense material base necessary to create the illusion of an immaterial digital financial world. The more invisible and immaterial a process becomes, the larger its underlying material base to support that, you might say. And so this material base has two functions. The stakes of abstract financial investments and products are often very material, such as wheat scarcity, shortage of drinking water, the closing down of factories, even the death of people. Financial markets are in fact able to quantify and price everything. Future hurricanes are compressed into catastrophe bonds. Bets are made on the spreading of the Ebola virus. Endangered species are vaporized into speculative financial products. The other function of the material base is infrastructure. I'm, for example, interested in a never-ending rat race for reducing latency and maximizing trading speed. In an ongoing work, the Infrared Line, I explore the telecommunication infrastructure that serves as the physical backbone of the financial markets. More than 95% of data travels through cables in the deep sea. Our so-called cloud is more like a spaghetti under our feet. But these cables have to come on land and in our sight somewhere. Although the exact places are mostly classified, I visit, film, photograph these places to get a better understanding of how this quest for increasing trading speed affects our physical surrounding and landscapes. So this is sort of drawn with all the current points where the submarine cables come on land. Here detail. And here just quickly some stills from videos that are made at these points around the world. So this is a Mauritius data center behind the cable landing point, Murmansk in Russia in the harbor. This is France, where actually the winter before the cable through storm came on the beach. France is very good in kind of hiding these sort of very critical zones because they always turn them into nature reserve parks. Whereas in the US it's much more a sort of clearly security zone. This is quite interesting. This cable was dug only like 3 years ago, so it still has really the scar of the digging in the landscape. So when you arrive at the beach, you just see the scar and you follow the water inland. And then there's suddenly a guard with a gun in front of you, and then you know you're at the right place. This is a cable landing point at the Bering Sea, Russia, where they're now going to construct the first Arctic cable. Because of the melting ice, it becomes possible to actually, for the first time, connect London and Tokyo via the Arctic, which will cut down the trading time for milliseconds, but for them it's really important and a big profit for the traders. Some more. Dealing with infrastructure obviously also means dealing with history. The origins of the financial backbone lies in the spatial organization of the British Empire. In the 19th century, the British Empire built a global network of submarine cable lines that functioned as the eyes and ears in its colonies. The submarine cable network was constructed in such a way that it would not cross foreign territory, and it was called the All Red Line. Via this global spider web of telegraph lines, British colonies were from very early on connected to the financial center of London, and still do so today via fiber optic cable. This is one of the reasons why secrecy tax havens of today are former British colonies. When money became disconnected from the gold standard in the 1970s and basically became mobile data, large sum of this mobile data was parked in the old colonies because they were tightly wired up in the nerve system of the submarine cables and yet distant enough not to contaminate the center of the Commonwealth. Here you see some documents. These are also, I also like always, these sort of stamps that really refer to this cable industry. This brings me to the last condition that gives global finance a nearly invisible character, geographies of avoidance. And for this, these two quotes are useful. More often than not, we gaze upon finance at a distance from media. Finance seems to happen somewhere else. Globalization isn't just about profits, it's about taxes too. Taxidus, the work that's also in the exhibition, is a work on corporate tax avoidance in the form of an online real-life game. Players acting on behalf of multinationals have to dodge paying as much tax as possible as they can within a strategic landscape that incorporates real data on withholding taxes and tax treaties around the world. By setting up intermediate holdings globally, players reveal potential routes through which multinationals in reality can neutralize their tax burden. Maybe I flip through some images. So the game starts by you can choose the company that you work for. Then you are sort of confronted with this global work, where to start. So you always start where the company is basically based, where it has a headquarters. And then you have to start up setting mailbox companies all around the world to kind of bring down your tax burden. And on the left side, you can see the tax that you have to pay, let's say in reality, and on the right side, how you can cut the tax down. So this move is not so good because it actually goes up. You have all sorts of very specific data, and then slowly you kind of construct this route, this tax planning route, sometimes very complicated, but that also mimics real life. And at the end, basically each player, when you finish the game, you contribute your route to the database. So by playing, you actually crowdsource the research on potential routes, so that's also accessible for everyone. So even today, tax havens recall the image of tropical islands with bank secrecy where celebrities park their money. Yet offshore financial centers have long ceased to be an exotic sideshow to the global economy. Now they are at its very core. It is wealthy OECD countries in particular that play a major role in this offshore economy and offer multinational numerous opportunities to evade financial regulation legally. In this global competition for investment, nation states lower their corporate tax rates more and more. After all, capital always chooses the path of the least resistance. What are those paths today? So in a way, the game tries to open up this practice also for a general audience to understand how it works. And actually, when I was, here you see one of the reports more closely, when I was working on this game, I was actually doing a residency in Dakar, and close to the area where we were, there was this hotel that was kind of, the construction of the hotel stopped. And there was this dispute, legal dispute, for a long, long time. And I started looking at what this hotel was, and then I found out that it was actually a company in Kuwait that started building here on the shore in Dakar illegally, in a way, this hotel. And then I looked a bit into their structure, and it also showed that they had a mailbox company in Switzerland. And so in a way you can see these ghosts, even though the game is of course very abstract, but we're all the time surrounded by these kind of ghosts of this tax planning industry. So today's gathering your financial body is a strategy to disappear off the grid. This practice is not exclusively for the corporate world. Small islands and countries in crisis increasingly sell passports as their gateway to the global economy. For wealthy individuals, multiple citizenships become a gateway to personal sovereignty and liberty, and a way to avoid financial regulation. They become the pioneers who can break free from nationality, who are lawsuit-proof and blend into any surrounding. The Osiris myth tells the story of the Egyptian king Osiris, who was drowned by his brother Seth. Osiris' drowned body is then found and brought back to life by his wife Isis. Enraged by his brother's rise from the dead, Seth murders Osiris a second time and cuts the body up in pieces, scattering them all over Egypt to prevent his revival. Yet Osiris' reign becomes embedded in the soil. The body becomes the territory. Rather than diminishing his supremacy, the scattering of Osiris' body is distributed over a broader terrain. The scattering can be likened to the way today wealthy people can scatter their national and financial body to reduce sovereign risk or control. And so the idea of national citizenship today has become liquid. It is no longer necessarily a product of your culture or nationality, but an asset to be purchased, traded, or revoked. Liquid citizenship is a work which gathers today, international data on citizenship opportunities and exemptions, and enables you to explore the offers available for purchasing a national passport or acquiring citizenship through other means, such as naturalization, people smuggling, or asylum seeking. In a cosmopolitan utopia, citizenship operates increasingly through commodification and confiscation. On the one hand, the emerging economic citizenship, aka citizenship by investment or golden visas, allow individuals to buy themselves into a country and benefit from its low tax and other liberal regulations. In that sense, economic citizenship is a high-end commodity only accessible to elite consumers. Others who want to establish a new citizenship are limited to bureaucratic naturalization procedures or have to flee their country of birth to be smuggled into other countries as illegals. In contrast to commodification, governments increasingly revoke citizenship to prevent or punish citizens from engaging with hostile ideas or groups. Today, revoking citizenships and passports and denying citizenships the right to return from abroad are all part of European and North American counterterrorism strategies. The United Kingdom leads in citizenship deprivation and has stated that citizenship is a privilege, not a right, that can be taken away from individuals if the authority decides it is in the public's interest to do so. When citizenship is conceptualized as a contract that expires with misbehavior, numerous questions arise. By which ideological flux is misbehavior determined, and by whom? And what happens to people who become stateless because of loss of citizenship? In a landscape where liquidity of citizenship is accelerated by commodification and deprivation, liquid citizenship offers a glimpse of the increasing possibilities of how this legal status can be dropped and picked up at will, or by force. Different profiles and networks enable access to various citizenship markets. You can browse, compose, and download your own citizenship profile. So this is a website online, you can go there as well. Basically how it works, you enter the website, and then you are given a profile. So here I'm from Belize, but I have quite high net worth, which means that I am kind of possible to buy a citizenship somewhere. So then I get into this sort of online store, and I can sort of filter what I would like to do to get the citizenship. So sometimes you have to make a donation to the government, sometimes you have to buy government bonds, and this is based on all realistic data, of course. But and then it filters out where you can kind of buy your citizenship. More information. This is not so sure. But if you get a profile where you actually your net worth is really low, then you get into another part of the website where you maybe only have the options to get into another country by being smuggled there illegally or through processes of naturalization. So on the left side, the options for being smuggled, but I see that I'm not considered to have a refugee status, so my only option is naturalization. Here I do have this option because I'm from Pakistan now. And then also while browsing through this, you get confronted with sort of pop-ups that speak about, you know, do you really want to have a British citizenship, because other British nationals were deprived of their citizenship. Next to the short-term effect of financialization of citizenship, there will also be long-term effects on the sense of belonging. It could accelerate the disconnect between the self and the experience of belonging somewhere. Your roots are no longer a consequence of your family or migration history, but a financial construction to be designed for the future. To conclude, the motivation for making these games and applications is to create a participatory space to explore and question these processes. Finance as a large distributed object through time and space cannot only be grasped in single images or representational maps. We need to imagine other ways of how to engage with these network processes. Whereas many in the world fight for visibility and recognition, the financial world is pushing the boundaries of its invisibility. In the context of finance, a global imagination is based on the possibilities to disappear into the cracks of global connectedness. How do we as human beings imagine a global connectedness that is increasingly designed for and by legislation, algorithms, and speculative financial products? Where lies the imaginary in finance?